Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear wonderful people, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Yes, I have my flu, but I can't let you down, so I need to do this pep talk. It's going to be brief, pretty, and to the point. One of the big problems that I face today in giving da'wah to the non-Muslims is what comes next after they accept Islam? What can I offer them that's going to make them feel closer to Allah? What it is that I can give them that's going to take them away from where they are right now, the society, the community of shirk and shaitan, everything, and where am I going to put them? Honestly, think about it. If somebody says to you and goes, okay, I want to become a Muslim, it's pretty, you're going to feel happy, and you're going to say, just say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, I've said it. Where are you going to take them? How are you going to take them salat? It becomes a responsibility. What I'm trying to get to with this pep talk here is that at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before they gave da'wah to anyone, they created an environment. They created a safe pond, so to speak, where any fish that is in the ocean and feels a threat of shirk and disbelief, as soon as they convert to Islam, they jump into this beautiful pond called a community, a Muslim community. Can any one of us pinpoint to a Muslim community, a true community? I don't think we have any. And those people that have come to Islam, it really is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided them. Because if I personally have known Muslims as they are today, I would never ever come close to Islam. Question to you. Ask yourself, if someone embraced Islam with you, what comes next? Well, usually it's a friend here, friend there, or maybe a group here, a group there. It's very, very appalling, the state of us Muslims today. And I'm not talking about the world. I'm talking about the Muslim community today. How can we build one? Well, the best way to build it is take the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and build on that. What did he do when he migrated to Mecca, to Medina, I beg your pardon? What it is that he did? Well, the very first thing he did was create a masjid, something that's going to hold the Muslims together. It was not easy to find the spot, but hey, they built a masjid. Then came what? Well, before he built the masjid, he made a statement. That statement is, I swear to Allah, if we apply it today, it will get results. And this is by Abdullah ibn Salam. Abdullah ibn Salam is a Jewish person. This young rabbi heard and has read that it was the time that a prophet should come now. The Jews have read in their Torah that this prophet was coming out and they knew he was coming in Yathrib. This is Medina today. This is why they migrated to Al-Madinah, the biggest three tribes there. Because they were hoping and wishing that when the prophet comes out, he will come out from one of the three tribes, and this is why they were in Al-Madinah and not in Mecca. Alrighty, the Prophet ﷺ comes to Al-Madinah, the Jews have heard of him. But they didn't want to accept him deliberately because they said he must come out of Al-Madinah. Abdullah ibn Salam, one of the rabbis of the children of Israel, heard of this man, Muhammad, coming to Al-Madinah. So he went to spy, and he said, as in Sahih Bukhari, he wanted to double check if this man was really a prophet or a liar. And he said, I was very good at checking out people's faces. Well, the people gathered around Rasulullah, and Abdullah ibn Salam said something absolutely fantastic and beautiful. He said, the first thing that I heard this man say was, Ya ayyuhan nas, أطعموا الطعام وأفشوا السلام وصلوا بالليل والناس نيام تدخلون جنة ربكم بسلام. And this hadith is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya ayyuhal nas, people. And the address here was not only to the believer. He was addressing everyone that was present there. Muslim, Jewish, or non-Muslim. And he said them, أطعموا الطعام, i.e., feed each other, invite each other for dinner, have community food together, go out, eat together. وَأَفْشُوا السَّلَامُ, and spread the name of Allah, as-salam, amongst you, or as the Jews say, shalom. وصلوا بالليل والناس نيام and pray at night when people are asleep and this is قيام الليل. قلوا you will enter the Jannah of your Rabb of your Lord in all safeguard and peacefulness. Allahu Akbar. When Abdullah ibn Salam said, he goes, by Allah, I knew that the face of that man was not a face of a liar. And he embraced Islam there and then. Subhanallah, he didn't say la ilaha illallah. He didn't say I am Muhammad Rasulullah. He didn't say anything. Look today, the non-Muslims, when they want to get together and have a nice catch up and things, what do? They go to restaurants. Let's have a bite to eat and talk. We Muslims, you don't do these things. There is a certain magic in eating together. Wallah al-Azim. There is a certain magic in eating together. Today we are also individuals, so disunited, so disrupted, so detached, so individualized. We look like, subhanAllah, in Al-Quran, Allah says, تَحْسَبُهُمْ جَمِيعًا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ شَتَّى. You think they are all together, but their heart are scattered away from each other. He spoke this about the non-believers. So how come we Muslims today, we are in that state? It's because we have become individuals. Someone spends a lot of money buying car, and the other one spends a lot of money buying houses. And someone spends money to look good, and someone does this. However, when it comes, for example, to the basics, seek knowledge about Islam, nobody wants to do that. And everybody wants a lot from Islam. So my question to you is this. If somebody came to embrace Islam, what community are we going to take them? And there are people that have embraced Islam only to quit it after that because they come. When we give them da'wah, we say big words. And then when they come into Islam, our actions are so little, so midget, so non-existent. And then they find this big culture shock coming into Islam and these liars. Somebody, subhanAllah, in the name of Islam, they pretension, their beards are very tall, very long, their actions are satanic. They wear a thawb, and Muslims today, they are decorated outwardly. Internally, ain't nothing that is of Islam except fake words here and there, la ilaha illallah, and the majority of Muslims do not know the implications and the demands of la ilaha illallah. They don't even know what the meaning, except that there is nobody to worship except Allah. If this was that, Quraysh would have said it just to end up all these headaches. What it is that Quraysh has understood that we do not understand? Why are we so disunited? My question to you. Yes, you're going to hear these words here and you're going to feel bad and you're going to feel sad. My question is, what are you doing to break this wall? What are we doing? What are we doing? We ask people to come together, they don't come together. We ask people to unite, we don't unite. And then we say the West doesn't like us. I swear to you, I don't like a lot of the Muslims today, and I am not a disbeliever. But when I see their actions, their behaviors, their attitudes, the way they are, the way they treat Islam. Today I was in the conversation with a convert, and she was telling me how the community took advantage of her. And it was like appalling, really appalling. It gives me, and many women today that are in troubled marriages, their problems are always based on the ignorance. Ignorance from her side and ignorance from the abuser, the man. Ignorance from her end because she didn't know her Islamic right. And she tells me, and I say, why did you marry this loser? She goes, I liked his Islam. When her Islam is zero, to me it's mind-boggling. Look at it this way. If I don't know how to count from 1 to 100, if someone says I can count from 1 to 500, in my eyes these people are mathematicians, they are clever, they are geniuses. When in fact maths are equations and geometry and algebra and algorithm, and there is all this world out there. And then at the end, when someone comes and brings the whole maths to me, I see that actually I was ignorant. A lot of people, he has a long beard and he looks pious. No wonder the problems are today so overwhelming in the Muslim community. 20 years ago, we had a beautiful Muslim community. 20 years later today, it sucks, big deal. 20 years from now, it'll be no community at all. So my question is, if someone embraced Islam, where would we take them? which stupid, which idiot person who claims to know about Islam is going to take care of them? Who's going to make them see the right path? What are we going to tell to Allah on the Day of Judgment when He tells us, you were in a country, England. Animals have their rights, and there are organizations that work to safeguard the rights of animals. Homosexuals, they are strong together. Atheists are strong together. Hare Krishnas and this Krishna and that religion are strong together. What have you done for my religion? If I wanted to convert to Judaism, Allah forbid, all I have to go, I go to a synagogue and I walk in there, Rabbi, I want to become a Jew. You know what? I'll be incorporated in a community right there and then. If I wanted to become a Christian, Allah forbid, all I have to do is go to a church. And then I will have a community to grow with, people that are going to sympathize, people that empathize with me, people that are going to smile and they're going to love me for who I am. If I wanted to be a Hare Krishna, the same thing, and this and that, Buddhist and all that kind of stuff. The only religion that sucks, big deal, is Islam. You go to Islam, you're alone. We're going to take advantage of you. When I used to work with Yusuf Islam, Cat Stevens, when I used to work with him, in Muslim Aid, when it started, I worked for 3.5 years. I have seen him abused and taken advantage of by so-called Muslims. I've seen people come with a long beard to us, and they look like angels, only to turn into Satans after that. I have seen what it's mind-blowing today. Time has passed, and guess what? I am still at the beginning of it all. If someone embraced Islam, where would I take them? Where? And when I say let's build a community, everybody is busy. Well, I'll tell you something. If you are too busy to give your time to Islam, I pray to Allah to put busyness in your hands, between your eyes, so that you never ever be free from this religion until you die. And then when you die, I want to see your face. What excuse you're going to give to Allah? You need to build a purpose for your life. You need to build a purpose for what you stand and believe in. Community is a necessity. Is a necessity. Pretty soon, young people, I'm going to start collecting money to buy food, to buy lots of food, and then hire a hall, and we're going to meet up there and have food together and eat together. We want that connection. We want that humanity, so that if someone comes to Islam, you can bring them to that moment there. You know what I like about the Tablighi Jamaat? A lot of people, they say it's innovation, it's bid'ah. But you know what? They do lots of good job. If I want to feel with the Muslims, I can go 3 days out with them. And guess what? I will feel in a community. And that's something I'd like to do. I've done it once and I really liked it. I spent with them like 20 days. And it was really totally awesome. Masjids and community, and you bond with people and all that kind of stuff. In my days of rock and roll and concerts and everything, I used to bond with a lot of people, musicians, and it was beautiful. It was a beautiful community. So hard that when today you tell me Islam is a religion, I can see music gathering people more than Islam does. Not because of Islam, but because of our failure. So my question to you right now is, if someone embraced Islam right now, where would you take them? Food for thought. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa, 078-7640-8735. Do listen to this and distribute it for the love of the Almighty. We need to create a community. Otherwise, we are doomed. The day we get slaughtered like the children of Israel in Egypt, ain't nobody is going to help us. Nobody. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.